feels like the AHC is working today, so.
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Corner Canyon Church. Would you stand as we start our worship service in the form of music and song and praise?
Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found.
couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, sovereign love of God. Lord, to know that you are in control, to know that you hold our lives in the palm of your hands, and to know that your eye is fixed upon us, calling as a father to his child, and both in adoration that we, as ugly and detestable as I would be, God, that you would love me, is a miracle. And I can't thank you enough, but I start here and now. Whatever the week has brought, wherever my mind has been, whatever sin has found a hold, may it be released. This morning, as we worship you, as we say thank you, as we open our hearts to you, to our minds and our ears, and as we desire more of you. So come, fill this place. We love you, we praise you, we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Again, welcome. Welcome to Corner Candy Church. My name is Johnny. And as always, a blessing to worship with you. It's nice to have a little reprieve from the heat this morning. If you are new or visiting with us, we do have some materials in the back. We've got some books and Bibles and coffee mugs, and those are yours for the taking. Please, we encourage you, take those and enjoy. My family and I are reading through Prodigal God right now, and it's a wonderful, wonderful book by Timothy Keller, and that's back there, and there's other resources. Please, that's our gift to you. We also have children's ministry ages 0 to 6 are welcome to join us downstairs through the entirety of the service, and then ages 7 to 11 will be dismissed after the worship music portion, or else they can join us for the service, which is also a blessing. We have these little placards or white bulletins that you may have seen in front of you or been handed out, and those contain additional information with ways to connect with our worship nights, with our men's breakfasts, with our home studies and community groups, and lots of different ways to connect. Is Ron here? Are the Dresslers here? No. Okay. We've got, I know there's a new, the Dresslers have started a new young couples group, which is really important, really good. I talked about that last week, so please, I encourage you, reach out to me, and I'll get you more information about that as well. But a couple special announcements. On the 12th, that's a Friday, we've got a lock-in, and a youth lock-in. This time, I won't say anything embarrassing about that. But it sounds like a good time and a fun time. But I think we also need volunteers for that. So if you want to hang out, play some games of all types, and not get any sleep with the youth, please see Josh. Josh, you want to raise your hand? Or Perrin, or Jacob, or myself, or Nate, or anybody, and we'll get you in the right place. But again, we need some parent volunteers to help. Is that right, Josh? You would still like some more help. Okay, so youth group on Thursday night is canceled because then the following day is the lock-in. Okay, great. We do have some other things that, if you're looking for more additional ways to connect or, frankly, to serve or volunteer, we have many, many ways in which we are still in need for volunteers. So come see myself. We need people, volunteers in the nursery, holding babies. We need help, continued help with the AV team. We need help in many different areas. And then there's like lots of, as we've expanded and grown as a church, the Lord has given us many opportunities, as he does, to foster the community or love on each other. And you'll see that in our call to worship, what a beautiful thing it is to be together in unity. And part of that means sometimes stepping out of our comfort zone to serve one another. And there are many, I get all the phone calls. Let me just tell you, I get the phone calls and the emails from the church. And I can tell you, there are lots of ways in which we can serve and help and love on each other. So come find me or Pastor Nate or others that you see around frequently, and we can help you, point you in the right direction. A couple other last-minute things. Wednesday night, we've got a special concert. I'm looking forward to it. It's going to be fun. And I'm going to play a few original songs, and we're going to have some guests. And I'll just kick the evening off. But it's going to be a good night. These are some great artists. It's free. And it's we're just hosting it, but it's put on by another pastor friend of mine from the Valley. And just this, to me, it encourages me to know that other churches, A, want to just come and hang out, but that we're willing to kind of work together to both just express worship and art through through music and things like that. So please come. That's this Wednesday at 6:30. And as a result, the community group that normally takes place at 7 p.m. will not be taking place this week to give room for the concert. So please come, have fun, and bring friends. It's free. I think they'll ask for, you know, a donation or something at some point. But yeah, come and join us. All right, well, that is our announcement time. Would you stand as we... as I read our call to worship. And as we continue through the Psalms today, we are at Psalm 133. And as I read it this morning, I was reminded that only Jesus draws the lines in the sand. And again, we are reminded so often by Jesus and others that to be known by our love is the greatest signal that something is different, right? To be known by our love for each other is something that is no longer necessary in much of the world's eyes, right? To be independent is more valuable. But what we find is that when we are independent from God, that we are also separated from each other. So my prayer is as we read this, that we would be reminded, just as David reminds us that it is a true blessing when we dwell together in unity. So Psalm 133 says this: "Behold how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head running down on the beard of Aaron, running down on the collar of his robes. It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore." Now back then they didn't have the symbol of oil coming down your head. That may not sound refreshing to you, but it meant two things. A, it was kind of oil is what they used for anointing, for a symbol. But it was also in many ways in which they protected their skin. And so as we signal to the world our love for each other, then we are giving them part of God's blessing, which he's given us. And now we need it more than ever.
Forsaken, and I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Forgiven. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. May I honor you. I'm forgiven. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit lives within me because you died and you rose again.
Amazing love. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love, and hearts unfold like flowers before thee, opening to the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt away. Giver of immortal gladness, fill us with the light of day.
All thy works with joy surround the earth and heaven reflect thy ways. Stars and angels sing around the center of unbroken praise.
Filled and rushing sea, chanting bird and flowing fountain, call us to rejoice in thee. Thou art giving and forgiving, ever blessing, ever bless, wellspring of the joy of living, ocean depth of happy rest. Thou art Father, Christ our brother, all who live in love are thine. Teach us how to love each other, just to the joy divine. Joyful music, lead us sunward in the triumph song of life.
You are
God teach us the meaning of trust. I confess that I may trust some parts of you, some elements, some realities of you, and I may fully ignore others. Lord, may my faith be more than just words, more than even just a belief. But may they be rooted in the experiences that I have with you, in the knowledge through your word and through your spirit that we have with you. Because it is in your presence, it is in the knowledge that I'm loved and known by you that I find peace. And Lord, may we reach out for this peace, which you so freely offer. In you, we live and breathe and have our purpose. All we have is yours, all we are is yours, and all we aim to be is what you'd have for us to be. And it is in this beautiful knowledge that we say thank you and we praise you, Almighty God, everlasting Father, now and forever. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated. And children, 7 to 11 are dismissed if they so choose.
Well, good morning. Good morning. Welcome to Corner Canyon Church. I'm Nate, the pastor here. And just as a reminder, so this Sunday at 7:30, it's going to be 20s and 30s, young adults. We meet out there around the patio barbecue and fire pit area. And it's just basically we all have burgers and we just hang out and talk, ask questions, questions about, you know, God, the meaning of life, the Bible. So it's just very kind of a relaxed young adult hangout, which is today at 7:30 p.m. out on this patio. So it's just a great time of fellowship. And then also, yes, Johnny mentioned we need volunteers. You can sign up for right next to the table over there in the corner. There's ways you can sign up, get more connected, and then in the future we'll have more ways people can get connected. And so you can, you know, help clean the church and mow the lawn. We always want the lawn looking good, I guess. So that's always a cool thing. And so also, I'm not going to forget this because this is really important, and this makes this a very, very special day. But today we are in ordaining and installing Rex Pickett and Eric Hycade as elders. So if I'd have you guys come up here. Just a great thing to have more men help in leadership and help in other variety of capacities. These guys are great, and it's a blessing to have them on board to help make decisions and just support the ministry here. So I'm going to ask you guys a six I do questions, and then we'll go from there. So first is, do you believe the scriptures of the Old and New Testament as originally given to be the inerrant word of God, the only infallible rule for faith and practice?
I do.
Do you sincerely receive and adopt the confession of faith and the catechisms of this church as containing the system of doctrine that is taught in the Holy Scriptures? And do you further promise that if any time you find yourself out of accord with the fundamentals of this system of biblical doctrine, you will, on your own initiative, make known to the elders the change which takes place, in your view, since the assumption of your ordination vow?
I will.
Do you approve the form of government and discipline of the PCA in conformity to be with the general principles of biblical polity? Do you accept the office of ruling elder in this church and promise to faithfully perform all the duties thereof and endeavor by the grace of God to adorn the profession of the gospel in your life and to set a worthy example before the church of which God has made you an officer? Do you promise a subjugation to your brethren in the Lord?
I do.
Do you promise to strive for the purity and peace and unity and edification of the church? Well, this is a beautiful moment in the life of our church, and we're going to, as a sermon, we'll look more and more at the purpose of elders and deacons and kind of go into more explanation. But for now, I am proud to say, I now pronounce and declare that Rex Pickett and Eric Hycade has been regularly elected, ordained, and installed as ruling elders in this church, agreeable with the word of God and according to the constitution of the PCA, and that as such, you're entitled to all encouragement, honor, and obedience in the Lord, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's give them a hand. You guys come here. I'm going to pray for you both, and that we'll go back to the normal order of service. God, I pray for these men, for their ordination. I pray that through this office that you would bless them, bless the church, help them to love you, Jesus, serve faithfully according to your word. May you strengthen them and be with them, and just may this leadership change be a great encouragement to us, as we should expect. You are working in this church. We are thankful for your grace, thankful for raising up these godly men that serve Christ's flock here. And may they help and support the cause of the gospel, that many people, through their help and leadership, would bring people to trust in you for saving faith, that they would know that you are their Savior, you've died for all of their sins. Use these men not to point to me or point to themselves, but use all of us as elders to point to you, Lord Jesus, for truly you are the head of the church. You have the final authority, and may you be glorified in these officers and in our lives, Lord. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, guys. God bless you guys. Thank you. Yeah. So we are a Bible preaching church. We go verse by verse through the Bible. We're currently in Romans. We're going to be taking a two-week break because we're going to be discussing, you know, issues in the church. You know, we've had a congregational meeting. We've ordained and installed new elders. So we're going to be kind of explaining kind of what we do here at Corner Canyon Church, why we are convicted by what the Word of God says. But we go through books of the Bible typically without, like, you know, small exceptions like Easter and elder ordination and congregational meetings. But we are a Bible preaching church. We go verse by verse of the Bible. And we're looking at Romans, and we will continue that study in two more weeks. And we're going to be in Romans 8. So we're getting towards, like, the halfway point here. We're at the halfway point. So we're making good progress on this. But this morning, we're going to be looking at the question of who runs the church according to what the Bible says. So let's pray that God would bless and anoint that message this morning. Dear Lord Jesus, we pray that this morning you would be glorified, and that through this message, through how your church is to be organized, how it is to be run, how it is to be viewed, may that bring glory to you. For as we will see in your word, you have the ultimate authority, Jesus, over your church. You are the head of the church. And if there's somebody here who has not placed their trust in you, you are faithful and reliable to forgive them of all of their sins. You are infallible, Lord, to forgive them all of their sins. If they trust in you, they can have eternal life this morning. So if somebody is here who has not embraced you as their Lord and Savior by faith, may you work in their hearts mightily to change them and to have them trust in you as their Savior. Thank you, Jesus, for the grace you have given us. Thank you for raising up godly men to support the cause of the church. May our church be blessed and grow in your grace. We love you, Jesus, and thank you for this time we have to honor and glorify you, and it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. So as I said, we're looking at the question of who runs the church, right? And the answer is me. I am the Senate. No, I'm just kidding. I am. Oh. No, what is the authority? That was a joke. For not serious. We just got new elders, you know. So, yeah, what is the authority structure of the church? And that might strike you as kind of like a really academic, intellectual, heady question. But let me assure you, like, this has really practical importance in our day. And if you answer this question the wrong way as to who runs a church, then what happens is that massive churches that have thousands of members can fall literally, and I do mean literally, overnight, very easily, people can be misused and abused, spiritually abused, with relative ease if there's not a proper system of authority, if there's not a proper system of checks and balances. And what's really interesting is there is a recent podcast from Christianity Today, very popular, which documents this really very brutal, kind of harsh reality. And the basic thrust of this podcast was a document. It seemed more like an autopsy of a dead church. It documents the rise of this massive megachurch in Seattle and the fall. And this is one of the largest churches in North America. And it grew so quickly, and it fell seemingly overnight. And this is such a popular church. It was really on the map. It had so many sites all the way down from Seattle down the way to California. And it had 15,000 people. I mean, there are towns where, frankly, like, there's not even 15,000 people. And this church was massive. And what's really shocking is when you think about it, because, I mean, my operating assumption is that, like, okay, I think, okay, smaller churches, they're going to be more unstable, right? Bigger churches, you think, okay, you got a lot of people going to this thing. You got a lot of people showing up, and a lot of these mega churches, they've mastered certain psychological techniques of drawing a large crowd with charismatic preachers, lights, mist machines, very, very loud music. So, you know, you think of this huge church, and I usually think, well, that's got to be a lot more stable than a smaller church, but you see, this podcast proved quite the opposite, and one of the main reasons why this church fell is because ultimately it was controlled. And it was managed by this very influential, popular pastor. He was a celebrity pastor, really. And the pastor had all the power. So when push came to shove, there was no checks, no balances. And the entire church was built around this celebrity pastor so that when he left, collapse. And it was so interesting is watching, listening to this podcast and seeing all the damage, harm, and pain he caused. This guy would fire people at a whim. And one story really stuck with me. He hired this secretary, and she was amazing. She was doing her job. She was really on top of it, a great support to this pastor. And another church member just asked very, very innocently, oh, so what do you like, how do you like working with the pastor? I mean, what are the pros and cons of it? She asked. She was like asking questions. Very innocent question, right? And she said a bunch of positive things. She gushed on about how great it was working with him, watching how his mind worked and everything. But she said, you know, I just wish he had older men around him to challenge him, to help him think and process through things, and help him grow, rather than him being surrounded by a bunch of yes men. And when the pastor heard this, this is going to be one of those moments where, like, wow, that really escalated quickly. I mean, that really got out of hand fast, right? He accused her of heresy and fired her on the spot. It was just like he fired her shortly after. It was unbelievable. And there was no investigation, no accountability here, no checking out claims. He had the ultimate authority to fire and hire people in this megachurch. This is how the Atlanta describes the fall of this notorious celebrity pastor. Unlike the notorious televangelist scandals of the 1980s, however, there was no single disgrace or crime that brought him down. Instead, it was a series of accusations of plagiarism, of crudeness, a bullying management style, unseemly consolidation of power, meaning he had unlimited power, a lot of power, and a squishy book promotion ethics, to name just a few. So this guy is able to operate with this unseemly consolidation of power, this authority structure, and no one's able to keep it in check, and so spiritual abuse takes place. And you think of how this church just fell overnight, and you compare it to a Coral Ridge Presbyterian church, where, you know, the founding pastor died, and the church is still going on, has thousands of people attending, and it has a biblical structure of authority in the church. But this church fell overnight. And so people who left this church, not only did the church fall apart, but people left with just severe spiritual trauma. And so that's why it fell, is this guy was able to operate for 10 years, and he's hurting you know, sheep after sheep. He's hurting person after person with this abusive, explosive anger of firing people, getting angry. And over time, it added up. And this is how bad it got. I just want to show you, because I know people have this idea, oh, we're talking about how the church functions or church government. Time to take a nap. No, I wanted to let you guys know this is super, super practical. This is how bad it got according to Paul David Tripp when he had this massive power, is that he would just fire pastors under him. He would be very abusive with them. And so this is what he said about people who were under his authority, other pastors. This guy was interviewing them. He was counseling them, giving them advice on how to go forward with these pastors that it was managed by this head celebrity pastor. He says, it was like sitting with guys who had come from Vietnam or something like that with PTSD. I have never been in a room with so many men who could not speak without weeping, and we wept too. I think it was one of the most emotional things I've ever experienced in my life. One of the saddest things I've ever experienced. If you stand back and you would do a summary description of what these men had witnessed and experienced, it was clearly one of the most horrifically dysfunctional leadership communities I have ever been exposed to. I didn't just weep for these men, I wept for the church. I wept for the cause of the gospel. And so you can see, yeah, church authority structure matters when this kind of abuse happens. And it matters how systems are set up. It matters on not just a practical level, which it certainly does. It matters on an eternal level, because if things are not set up properly, as Tripp says, it traumatizes people from the church, away from God. People and the cause of the gospel get hurt very badly. And the church is about promoting the gospel. And if a church is hurting people, that hurts the effects of the gospel. And the gospel is used to bring people to Jesus. It's to bring people to eternal life. It's to grow the kingdom. And so this has eternal impact. And it ultimately, which is very severe, detracts from the glory of God. So I would say, yeah, church authority structure, checks and balances and how they're set up, it matters with great eternal significance. Even though there are, of course, Christians who have godly men who disagree on how the church should be set up. Now, I have heard many good and godly men tell me straight to my face that the Bible does not address the issues of how the church should be structured in terms of authority. The Bible is not meant to address how the church should be run. But the Bible has nothing to do, they would say, with church government, church authority structures. But you see, this kind of thinking goes against exactly what the Bible has to say. In 2 Timothy 3:16 through 17, it says, all scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete or sufficient. He's made complete, equipped for every good work. The Bible builds up the man of God so that he is able to be equipped adequately, sufficiently, good enough to help set up the church. And so the Bible does provide instructions on how the church, which Christ himself set up, how it's supposed to function, how it's supposed to operate. And so scripture has brought into the discussion of how we should look at the church that Christ established. And what's really interesting, I find, is that the last books that Paul writes, just 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, and Titus. These are the books that Paul writes as an old man. Paul is dying. He's an old man. He's at the end of his life. He's at the end of his ministry. And he doesn't say, okay, here are rules for apostles. Here are rules for prophets. No, no. As Paul is dying and the apostles are dying off, they set up instructions not for more apostles, not for more prophets. In fact, they suggest that those offices have ceased. But they lay out the structure clearly in the last books of the Bible as elders and deacons. And so this is how Paul leaves us with these two offices and how the regular church, how we're to function until Jesus Christ comes back in his second coming. So this is what 1 Timothy 3:1 says. I'm going to look at kind of, we're going to go through this verse and analyze it verse by verse to understand it. But it says, the saying is trustworthy. If anyone aspires to be an office of overseer, he desires a noble task. Now, overseer, that just kind of sounds like supervisor, a spiritual leader, as we would understand as a pastor today. And so, yeah, he's talking about church leader. So, leadership here. And so how many elders are there supposed to be? How many overseers are there supposed to be? Are overseers and elders the same thing? Those are questions people have. They're good questions to ask. And we're going to look at what elder and overseers and the rest of it, of the officers, which is deacons. And so, you know, what I was raised with in my tradition growing up was you would have, there'd be one elder to rule them all, one ring to rule them all, one elder to rule them all, right? And then you'd have a bunch of deacons. That's how I was raised. And there were some pastors that went through that church that had like massive control. They were like dictators. They would like, one pastor, I grew up with this is great. Not really. But one guy would go around and randomly accuse people of selling drugs if he made more than the pastor. Oh, are you kind of doing drug deals on the side? People are like, what? Did you just make that up? Like, really? Like, you don't go up to someone like, hey, welcome to Quarter Canyon. So are you doing drugs? Okay, just want to make sure, you know. It's like, not necessarily the most friendly thing you want to start off with, right? Not good. So, yeah, and so this elder became kind of a dictator and would just randomly ask people bizarre questions. I've seen this happen many times. And so he was the main elder. But what the Bible actually teaches is many elders, a multitude of elders, not just one to rule them all. And you're going to see this in Titus 1 through 4, 1, 4 through 8. It says, to Titus, my true child, in a common faith, grace and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Savior. This is why I left you in Crete, so that you might put what remained into order and appoint elders in every town as I directed you. So notice elders, plural there, elders in every town as I directed you. If anyone is above reproach, the husband of one wife and the children are believers. We're going to get to that, what that means. And not open to charges of debauchery or insubordination, for an overseer, as God's steward, must be above reproach. He must not be arrogant or quick-tempered or a drunkard or violent or greedy for gain, but hospitable, a lover of good, self-controlled, upright, holy, and disciplined. So you notice it says here, elders are set up in each town. Now, Christianity at that point in time was very, very small. It's not the largest world religion like it is today. Like, you know, in one town, Draper, there's like multiple churches. That's not how it was. For one town, there was one church. So in every church in the first century, when the apostles were around, when they would set up a church, they would set it up with multiple elders, elders plural. And so this is how church leadership functioned. There was no centralized single leader who would call the shots like some kind of mob boss. That didn't happen. And so elders and overseers here are the same office because it says, yeah, it continues on, for an overseer, but it's talking about elders. So to be an elder is to be an overseer, just like to be a dad is to be a father, and to be a father is to be a dad. So to be an overseer is to be an elder. They're coextensive. They're the same reality. They're referring to the same thing there. Now, this is not the only part of the Bible that talks about church leader as not depending on one leader, one centralized, all-powerful leader, but many leaders here, and you see this in the book of Hebrews, Hebrews 13, 17, it says, obey your leaders and submit to them, for they are keeping watch over your souls. They're pastoring you, watching over your souls. As those who will give an account, let them do it with joy and not with groaning, for that would be of no advantage. So they notice that it's their leaders. So this is a part of the church, the book of Hebrews here. And so the people have leaders, and that's because they're a part of a church when they join the church. That's what it means when people talk about church membership like a heavy thing. It just means you're a part of a church. And so that's their leaders, right? Right there in the Hebrew congregation. So yeah, these leaders are governing this church. Not just one leader with all of the power, plural elders or leaders that run things up. And I think deep down inside, when we think about like one super powerful leader or one all-powerful leader, I think we get kind of the heebie-jeebies. We get like, I don't feel good about that. I'm kind of skeptical of that. And that makes sense in our democratic Western culture, which, by the way, was based on this form of government, which is interesting. But, I mean, we get this kind of, you know, negative feeling about a powerful leader. I mean, you see the Star Wars series, which I kind of incognito referenced, right? An all-powerful leader without proper accountability. In emergency powers, you know, Senator Palpatine, he's the bad guy throughout the whole entire Star Wars series, you know? He has the famous line, I am the Senate. unlimited power, right? So this guy's all powerful, and he does some really bad things, right? He manipulates people. He murders people. I mean, he wipes out the Jedis. I mean, how messed up is that, right? So we think of this unlimited power kind of leadership. It's a bad thing. And it's not just that, but there's many references in popular culture to how, like, one powerful pastor, one all-powerful leader that has, you know, calls the shots as the final say, that's not a good thing. This is what the renowned theologian Joe Rogan, he's not, you know, he's Joe Rogan, right? But I mean, even he's not a Christian, but he has some sense that, like, you have certain mega church pastors with this kind of all-powerful, like, no accountability leadership, and it's just weird, right? So this is what he says. The problem with the church is a problem with any sort of person who gets in a power position. And of course, all he knows are these megachurch pastors, which have unlimited power, right? He says, it's easy to abuse. So you have a guy who is a pastor that is not a creep and he really cares. He isn't trying to buy a Rolls Royce like Joel Osteen and live in a giant mansion. He says, it always goes south. It's absolute power. And so as you see, even Joe Rogan knows this. And by the way, Joe Rogan's not attacking the Bible here. He's attacking what certain pastors do when they abuse their power, when they have this sort of ultimate authority over the church. The Bible does not teach that. So he's not going after the Bible. The Bible, as we've seen, teaches this shared authority. Now, I want you all to hear me say this. I'm going to say it very clearly. I am not the boss here, okay? So if you have this picture of Pastor Nate, you know, maybe like with a cloak on Emperor Palpatine, don't do that. You know, you have this picture of Nate like, you're the pastor. He is the boss. Just erase it, delete it, right? Kind of thing, okay? Get rid of it. I am not the boss here, okay? We have equal authority. Rex, Eric, and Ron and I have equal authority so that I don't have Trump authority or anything like that over them. We have, according to the biblical model, we share that authority. I am not the boss. So you could technically call Eric and Rex pastor. Pastor Eric and Pastor Rex, you can do that. They're shepherding this church with me. Now, the obvious difference, I'm talking up here, they're not, is Eric, Ikeade, Ron, and Rex. They're ruling elders, whereas I am a teaching elder. Ruling elder, teaching elder. You're like, did you just make that up? Nope, comes from the Bible. 1 Timothy 5:17 says this. It says, let elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in preaching and teaching. So they're focused on ruling. I rule and I preach and I teach. So all elders are equally ruling, have equal power in ruling together jointly. And I just happen to be an elder who labors in preaching and teaching the word of God. Now, people still ask me, well, okay, maybe you all go crazy. So who holds you accountable there? You know, you've seen churches where all the elders go off the rocker. And so are there checks, are there balances for when that thing occurs? Is there contingencies for that? Who makes sure the elders stay in check? And the answer is a larger group of elders, a much larger group of elders that has authority over us and tries to ensure the church is running biblically, according to God's word, not according to our opinions or our ideas, but the ultimate authority, which is the Old and New Testament, the Bible. And you see in the Jerusalem Council that there was an issue of teaching elders who were teaching a false gospel. They were teaching that you were saved by good works, trying, striving, and doing certain Jewish laws like circumcision. And so this false gospel is being taught as works-based, kind of very Jewish, keep all the Jewish laws thing was being taught at that time, and said you got to add circumcision to, you know, faith, and you can't let the Gentiles in, they have to become Jews too, and all of this kind of thing. And so Paul brings it up to a larger group of elders and apostles, which Paul says in Ephesians has ceased. There's no more apostles today. But he says, yeah, they bring it up. They have an issue, a concern from a pastor who's preaching that you need to be saved by having faith in Jesus and by doing certain Jewish laws. And they say, uh-oh, that's a problem. We're bringing it up to the big guns because something's going wrong in these churches. They bring it up to a higher court. You see this in Acts 15:1. But some men came down from Judea and were teaching the brothers, unless you are circumcised according to the custom of Moses, you cannot be saved. So it's faith alone, or it's faith plus works here. This ultimately undermining the gospel of God's amazing grace. And after Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and debate with them, Paul and Barnabas, like they didn't get in like a fist fight to solve it. No, Paul and Barnabas and some were appointed to go up to Jerusalem to the apostles and elders about this question. And what you see here is they rule in favor of the gospel. This court of elders and apostles, they rule and they say, no, Gentiles are in only by faith. We're saved by faith and grace. And so there's a larger body, and they then go down to the smaller bodies, and they keep those guys in check that were trying to teach this false gospel. And so we are not an independent church. We don't do our own gunslinging John Wayne, we're independent. No, we have accountability. So that if I were to teach that there's many gods or that Christianity is not true, the Bible is false, something weird or whatever it is, I would get fired. We would be held accountable, and I would get fired for teaching a false doctrine. And so, yeah, this is a great system to keep not only me in check, the elders in check. And so there's a whole system of checks and balances. It's a representative form of government, of course. And so this works out, I think, great. Now people can still ask me, okay, well, what about the checks and balances for that larger body? Could the system still fall apart? Could it still fall through the cracks? And yes, it still could. It still really could. Anything that's run by sinful, imperfect people, by definition, isn't going to be perfect. Nothing's going to be perfect until you get to heaven. I hate to break it to you. But this is the best system we got. And it's the best system we got because it comes from the Bible, the Word of God. And it's this system only works properly, only functions properly, if elders and deacons fit the biblical qualifications here in Timothy. And that's why if elders and deacons are no longer qualified, they should step down. Because if they're living a life unfitting to a leader here, the whole system falls apart, because you'll have a bunch of morally corrupt people leading together, and that's going to, anytime there's two morally corrupt people and they disagree, it kind of goes south. And by kind of, it really does go south. And so this is why it's vital for church officers to be faithful and honest with these biblical qualifications. This is in 1 Timothy 3:2. Therefore, an overseer must be above reproach, the husband of one wife, sober-minded, self-control, respectable, hospitable, able to teach. Now, they're able to teach. Doesn't mean they have to teach. It just means if called upon, they could teach. So, yeah, it's if you look at this one of the most controversial ones here, the office of an elder is reserved for men who have a consistent pattern of monogamy in their life. They must be, as the phrase suggests, a one-woman man, one-woman kind of guy. This rules out guys who have a pattern of getting divorced, remarried, getting divorced, remarried, getting divorced, remarried, and this kind of persistent pattern will rule out somebody from being an elder. Now, someone could have a divorce in their past, and they're an unbeliever or whatever it is on biblical grounds, but that does not rule them out. But this is somebody who has a pattern of not being committed to one woman. And so there cannot be a man who has in his life many women, or a pattern of going to one woman to another romantically. This is the ideal that God set up in the Bible from the very beginning. You have one man, one woman, and in marriage, and that's the ideal. And going outside of that consistently hurts the soul. And this means things like adultery or any affair would disqualify a pastor or elder from office. Now, I want you to notice, and this, I'm sure you probably already did notice, is that it does not mention women as elders or deacons, and that's very true. But I want to say something here, headed off the pass. That does not mean women are not important and vital to the function of the church. If we didn't have women here, this place would fall apart. Right? And women are so essential to serving, to doing ministry in Christ's church. It's vital for the health of the church. And going into all the ways that women serve here and use their gifts is just amazing. And it would take a whole other sermon, maybe 5 sermons, to cover all the ways women can help and support the church. I mean, they have a crucial way in serving and leading others in the church. And I can personally tell you, my sermons got a lot better when my wife started reading them. Because before it was a little rough, right? My wife's like, yeah, you should take this out. You've got too many Star Wars references, I mean, this is, okay. Nate, are you really going to give the entire movie of Signs? You know, stuff. She challenges me. And so you guys get the benefits of my wife, looking at my sermons. And so women serve in so many ways in teaching capacities. Aquila and Priscilla instructed Apollos. That's a man and woman couple. So women serve in so many ways. But just in this passage, it's addressing the office of elder and deacons. Women have a huge hand and help in the church. 1 Timothy 3:3 says, he's not a drunkard, nor violent, but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. So an elder is not someone who's always drunk. I think that's pretty obvious, right? I mean, if you see a pastor getting drunk all the time, it's kind of a problem, as in kind of is totally a problem. And he can't be the kind of person who is highly disagreeable, you know? People who are just always on Facebook arguing all the time. You can't be, you know, a 24-hour Facebook warrior arguing with people at the church and everything like that, you know. An elder is someone who's not greedy but is generous in their giving and money, and they have a genuine need. If someone has a genuine need or a legitimate need, they give it to the church. They give it to people who are poor. It says, for he must manage his own household well with dignity, keeping his children submissive. If you recall the Titus passage, it says his children must be believers. And so I've heard people say this. I've heard many people say this. Well, you know, my 18-year-old daughter kind of fell off the rails. I got to resign. It's like, well, wait a minute. How were they talking about children in the first century? Like, people live at home till they're 30 now. You gonna call that a child? I mean, are they under your authority still? Well, no. And so we have to see, what did they mean by child in the first century? And the answer is, 12 or 13, by that time, you were viewed as an adult, right? So this is not talking about your 25-year-old, daughter or son who's still living with you and listens to Richard Dawkins CDs and, is an atheist. It's not talking about that. You're like, oh, he's become an atheist now. Got to resign my position as elder or deacon. No, this is talking about people like, look, I'm sorry. Like, if Kenny starts spouting, like, atheism to you and says, yes, God does not exist, my son, and Abigail's like, yeah, I hate church and I hate God. Like, that's a problem, okay? They're so young. When they're that young, they just repeat whatever you say. It's very simple. But if they hate you, there's no authority in the household, that's totally different than, say, a 25-year-old who's like, it's expensive to live in Utah. I don't believe in God. I'm going to live with my parents. That's totally different. And so when it's talking about children here, it's not talking about the 16-year-old going off the rails. It's talking about a 9 or 10-year-old that's spouting atheism or is defying their parents. That's a real problem in the house, which means that the elder can't manage the church if his 10-year-old kid is falling off the rails. 1 Timothy 3:5 through 6 says, for if someone does not know how to manage his own household, how will he care for God's church? That's the point he's drawing about the kids. He must not be a recent convert, or he may become puffed up with conceit and fall into the condemnation of the devil. Too much, too fast, you get promoted too much, and you get an Anakin, Skywalker complex. You don't want that, okay? So you want to be, this is somebody who's going to be walking with Jesus for a long time. By the way, my wife did not see this in the sermon. She would have said, Nate, that's too many Star Wars references. You got to cut it out. I'm adding it on my own as I go along, just so you know. So 1 Timothy 3:7 through 8 says, moreover, he must be well thought of by outsiders so that he may not fall into disgrace, into the snare of the devil. Deacons likewise must be dignified, not double-tongued, not addicted to too much wine, not greedy for dishonest gain. So yeah, church officers are not to be thought of as, wicked, evil men, that scam people, get drunk, get in bar fights. You don't want that to be an elder or deacon. That's not, you want to be thought of as positively. That's why we do elections for church officers. We have a vote to ensure that they have an honorable perception, that by making them an elder of this church, you're like, oh man, he's an elder at your church. He goes down to the bar every night, gets drunk and fights people. Like, you should not be making them an elder of your church. So that's why we do elections here. We do votes to ensure that there's an honorable perception about the elder or deacon in question. And so lastly here, again, it stresses how it's important it is for church officers to be generous to the church and to those who are in legitimate need, poor people. So yeah, they're to lead by their generosity in giving to those in need and to Christ's church. Finish up the section here is the qualifications with deacons as well. They must hold to the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience, and let them be tested first. Then let them serve as deacons if they prove themselves blameless. We usually give 6 months testing to deacons to make sure that this is something they can do. Their wives likewise must be dignified, not slanderers, but sober-minded, faithful in all things. Let deacons each be the husband of one wife. Same qualification from the elder there. Managing their children and their household well. Again, it's kind of stressing the same qualifications. For those who serve well as deacons gain a good standing for themselves and also a great confidence in the faith that is in Christ Jesus. People ask questions, why is there qualifications for deacons' wives, but not elders' wives? It's like, yeah, elders' wife, you can just do whatever you want, you know? Deacons' wives, you're held to a higher standard. You know, you notice it, it mentions deacons' wives. Well, I do think elders' wives have certainly standards. That was a joke, if that wasn't clear, okay? But deacons, why it mentions this, why it stresses that here, is because deacons work as a matter of service, as we'll see. They serve and help people with financial needs. And so when you're helping people that are messy, you don't want somebody who's running around gossiping about it. And so that's why you have these qualifications for deacons' wives here. And that really gets to the heart at the difference between an elder and a deacon. The word deacon means servant. So this is an office that functions as a serving physical needs. An elder is an overseer, and it's an office of ruling, praying, preaching, whereas deacon is an office of serving and helping. So typically, that's why, you know, you have deacons who help out with church building stuff, you have them help out with the needs. They wouldn't require as much doctrinal vetting as an elder would, because an elder has to be able to teach. And you see this distinction, this distinction is at the very earliest part of the Christian church. Look at Acts 6, 1 through 5. Now in these days, when the disciples were increasing in number, a complaint by the Hellenists arose against the Hebrews, because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution. This is a form of like racism here kind of thing. And the 12 summoned a full number of the disciples, saying, it is not right that we should give up preaching the word of God to serve tables. So that's the elder thing, is we're preaching. They help in ruling and all those things. Therefore, brothers, pick out from among you 7 men of good repute, full of the spirit and wisdom, whom we will appoint to this duty, but we will devote ourselves to prayer and the ministry of the word. That's the difference there. It's getting at the difference between elder and deacon. And it goes into those who they chose as deacons. So the focus here is on, yeah, elders praying, preaching, ruling, whereas deacons are far more focused on serving and helping people's physical needs. And that's why you'll notice they're typically consulted in the financials of a church, the church building, and they're helping. We have a deacon's fund here at the church. We help people that are struggling and are poor. I love this style of church government, because it's not like I sit up late just writing it down, making it up. It just comes from the Bible directly. And I love it also because it's not centered on one man, one powerful leader. It's not man-centered. It's Christ-centered. And that's what the Bible shows. This government shows us that there's equal authority spread out through godly men, as the word of God teaches. And the problem is when you have a leader like a super bishop, a boss elder, like some prophet who's ahead, or some massive apostle guy who thinks he's like, I've seen many people like where they're like, they call themselves apostle. I'm like, wow, you're an apostle. You saw the risen Jesus. That's what it meant to be an apostle. It's like, yeah, no, they didn't. They're just making that up and calling themselves up. You have like a head prophet, head apostle, you know, head honcho. And so the problem is all the focus goes to that guy or girl, whatever it is, and the focus doesn't go on Jesus. And this is why Paul says focus is not on some head prophet or head guy, head honcho. The focus is on Jesus. Jesus Christ. This is why there's no centralized authority, why authority is equally distributed and spread out, because it's not a man, a mere man, I should say, who is head of the church, but it is a God-man, Jesus Christ, who is the head of the church. That's not like just my opinion. This is what Colossians teaches us in chapter 1. And he is the head, Jesus, the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that everything he might be preeminent. For in him are all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. Jesus is God. And through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. So it's Jesus. He is the one that has unlimited power, not a man. He is the one that has ultimate authority in the Christian church. It is Jesus Christ, the one true God, forever and ever. And the Bible puts it here to remind us because we have a fallen tendency to look to powerful, charismatic, smart people to save us, to make us feel significant and like we are taken care of. We like to see a visible, tangible person right in front of us who has all the answers. We're attracted to powerful and charismatic leaders. We want someone to have a final say in the Christian church, to make us feel safe in our black and white thinking. We want a head priest, a head prophet to call all the shots. This is what we yearn for many times. And so we don't have to think or rely on at all. We want to rely on this one person to do all the thinking for us. God forbid we have to think about things and read the Bible and analyze things and be good Bereans, as Acts 17 says. No, that's the Bible says to check all things out. Check out your leaders by looking and reading the Word of God, not just saying, I don't want to think about it. I'm going to put my hand in the sand, just my head in the sand, and let this powerful leader call the shots. And so we're looking really there for a substitute Savior. We want a very powerful and charismatic megachurch pastor who displays his full power and confidence so we can feel safe and secure and gooey inside. Oh, he's got it all figured out. I don't need to worry about it. He's got it. Pastor's got it all figured out. And when we do that, we turn to the pastor. We don't turn to Christ in his word for help and wisdom because the head guy, hey, he's got it covered. He's got it all figured out. Just like the first century Jewish people, they wanted a physical earthly savior. We want the same thing to solve all our problems. And when we do that, we look away from Jesus. And this problem isn't a new problem. It's an old problem. It's one of the oldest sins in all of history. And it's called idolatry. See, the problem is we want to replace Jesus with these kind of phony, knockoff, substitute saviors. And when we do that, it will never bring us true fulfillment. It will always let us, making us feel empty. It'll always let us down, as many religious and cult leaders have done for hundreds of years in duping people. They will always let you down. They will always hurt you. And so when we look to 100 different things other than Jesus, which we do, our money, our success, family, our jobs, all of those things, we will never find true satisfaction in those substitute saviors, even though it's kind of our inkling and DNA to do so. We will only find life and peace in Christ alone and nothing else. And so, yeah, you know, to find this true lasting commitment that will last is in Jesus. But if you look to these other things, you will not find joy and contentment. You'll find hurt. And many people who have put another person as head of the church or has gone to them for ultimate spiritual authority, oftentimes those people are very narcissistic and they're very spiritually abusive. And so people get really badly hurt. They've relied on this person. And so what happens is they just associate church and God with abuse and money and power and all of these things. And so they don't trust church, you know, healthy churches. They don't trust the Bible. They're angry and hurt. And so our job here as elders at Corner Canyon is not to point to ourselves, because I will always let you down. All the elders here will let you down. We are sinful, fallen men. Though we are qualified, we're still sinful. Our jobs here as elders is to point you to the finished work of Jesus Christ, his perfect life, his death on the cross for all of your sins. It's our job as elders to point to Jesus, not to ourselves, to say repeatedly, I am not the Christ. Jesus Christ is the Christ. That's what we live for. And that's what we breathe for. And so if you have been hurt by church leaders, as I have been hurt by church leaders in the past, who have abused you, let you down, scarred you, and made you feel not worthy, not good enough, have put oppression over your life, know this, though they have hurt you, Jesus Christ will never hurt you. Though they have let you down and scarred you, Jesus only heals and helps you. He is the one reliable leader we can put our faith and trust in. No fallen, fallible, sinful man, only Christ alone. And if you've not done so this morning, I encourage you to trust in Christ. Where people have hurt you and ruined your trust, Jesus Christ is faithful. And that is the one secure foundation to place your trust in Jesus Christ and him alone. Let's pray. Jesus, we are so thankful that you lived the life we could never live, died the death we could never die,
and resurrected from the dead so that we know we could never merit salvation. It is only your merit. And your merit alone, which gives us perfect righteousness, as if we've never sinned, even though we have, because you took that sin on you 2,000 years ago. As we think about communion, may we know in our hearts, in the fullest sense, that all of our sins are forgiven by those who trust in him, that we have eternal life. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. So I'm just going to read here the purpose and function of communion. Josh did a great job explaining, you know, kind of our practice of frequent communion here and why it's so important. But I always want to remind us what the Word of God has to say about how we should think and reflect on ourselves as we partake in this. 1 Corinthians 11:23 through 29, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also he took the cup after the supper, saying, 'This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat the bread and drink the cup. For if anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself." People get confused sometimes as I read that. They think, well, you know, Nate, I don't feel like I'm good enough to take communion. And that's not what this is teaching here. It's those who sincerely trust in Jesus. Because you trust in Jesus because we all know deep down inside none of us are good enough. Jesus was good enough for us. By trusting in him, we have his righteousness. And if you trust in Jesus, you were clothed in his righteousness. And his righteousness is greater than all of your sins. His work on the cross cancels and annihilates all of your sins. They are forgiven. And so this is a great reminder of that truth. Because when we fall into sin, and we're just like, man, I messed up again. We think that we're not worthy. We feel like we are worthy in Christ only. We feel like that, yeah, well, I can't have communion. I'm not a believer. But this is a reminder that even though you fall short, Jesus is always there for you. And he's never going to stop loving you. So if you heard the message of the gospel and you trust in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior sincerely, then take communion with us this morning. If this is your very first time, do so. And if you're a believer who has been struggling with sin and you trust in Jesus to forgive you for all of your sins, this is that reminder. Reminder that it is covered by grace. Because you and I, we need all the grace that we can get. Can I have Eric and Rex come up, please? Really quick, come up and help serve the elements. And just a couple things about the communion. We have regular bread. And we have gluten-free bread, which is labeled. We also have red-colored cups, which would be the wine. The white is going to be the grape juice. And then if you feel more comfortable at your seat, we do have in front of you the communion elements that you can take there if you don't want to come up. But if you do like to come up, you can come up through this aisle, and then you exit on this aisle. And so please come up now and let us reflect on the finished work of Jesus Christ for you and me.
There's no one like you who walked through a tomb to prove that you love me. Oh God, there's no place to hide from your voice like a bride calling out to her love. My heart has no room left to wait. Let it fill with words of your praise. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. Glory and honor now and forever be thine. Blessed of the Lord Most High.
Let's take the elements together. This represents the body that was broken for all of your sins. Take and eat. This represents the blood that was shed for all of your sins. Take and drink. Let us give thanks and glory to Jesus Christ in prayer. Lord Jesus, we need reminders. We need to be reminded over and over and over again that you love us. Because often when we fall into sin, we forget, but you are there to remind us through visible elements, through the gospel, and you preach the gospel, and remember that you will always love us and always forgive us. And the sins that we cannot forget, you cannot remember, because they were nailed to the cross 2,000 years ago. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Would you stand as we close our service with the singing of the doxology. God bless you all. Go in peace.